It's March 21st, 2024. We're here at the World Health Organization for a meeting on a pandemic agreement. I'm talking to Priti, who's a journalist. And Priti, first I'd like you to introduce yourself and tell people about yourself and what you do professionally, and then tell people what you think about what's happening this week in the negotiations.
Hi, I'm Priti Patnaik. I'm the founding editor of Geneva Health Files, which is an investigative interdisciplinary initiative reporting on global health from Geneva, Switzerland, which is the capital of global health. So I'm a journalist here reporting on these negotiations and these discussions for the last 2 or 3 years. We are nearing the penultimate stage in the negotiations. It's still March, but we have only a handful of negotiating days left. So we are tracking the dynamics as countries get closer to the end. It's hard to predict which way this will go, but as on today, there are lots of process constraints and concerns that are dominating minds of negotiators. So they'll have to find a way to streamline process while also making progress on the substantive elements of the agreement.
What is has anything surprised you this week?
I think that there was a lot of expectation that the process would be different, I think I was expecting that we will probably witness somehow a faster pace of these discussions. So that has been surprising. But what's more surprising is, I must confess, the prevailing power dynamics. It was very evident at the beginning of the meeting, which was Monday, beginning of INB9 as it were, where you could see a lot of countries, especially developed countries, among others, also visibly upset about the way negotiations were being conducted and the text in front of them, so on and so forth. And for me, that was striking, because I felt that for the first time in over a year, and we have reported about this, that in over a year, you actually had developing countries being acceptable on the text, but you also had at the same time a lot of strong criticism of what was in front of countries, particularly by developed countries, and that for me was striking. And I think the mood has improved since over the last couple of days.
Coming from outside and then being here for 3 years, what do you think are the, what kind of misconceptions you think people have about negotiations in Geneva or the World Health Organization as it relates to this agreement? But, this is, you have an opportunity, you're right in the belly of the beast here. You're watching things really up close. What strikes you as a thing that's probably least understood about this forum?
I think first thing, a couple of issues, and it's a great question. I think the first thing is how it's fairly non-transparent, but in relation to other international organizations, I think the institutional processes in WHO are more open. The fact that we can be here and track the negotiations, talk to negotiators and so on, as opposed to, let's say, the WTO, for example. Also, I think it's important to keep in mind, and I was thinking about it recently, that although these negotiations concern a new pandemic agreement, for me these negotiations are landmark because they, irrespective of the outcome, they really have the potential to move the needle on a number of issues, from transparency, accountability, issues on pricing, and of course potentially new rules, in and of themselves, particularly on pathogen access and benefit sharing and so on. But not only, some of the legacy issues in global health in terms of access, not just access, but also state of the health healthcare workforce and so on. I think this is much bigger than an instrument to govern pandemics. I do think that this is a turning point in general for global health governance because it touches upon so many issues. So I think it is important to keep that perspective in mind that it is not just merely about an instrument to govern pandemics, but it's much wider than that.
How would you compare this negotiation to the WTO negotiations on COVID-19?
I think...
You've sort of hinted at it already. It's certainly a more ambitious agreement in terms of what they're trying to deal with.
Yeah, I think the WTO negotiations on the TRIPS waiver that went on for almost, 2.5 years were interesting in the sense that although they failed in effect, they have created a lot of space for these kinds of discussions at the WHO. And if you look at some of the most important contentious elements in the pandemic agreement, you will find the genesis of those discussions also in the TRIPS waiver discussions. Whether it is a more openness towards accessing trade secrets, regulatory dossiers, these issues are being discussed also here, and of course on exceptions to the use of TRIPS flexibilities and so on. But I think that there's no doubt that those discussions, although they did not reach their logical conclusion in some way, did make a lot of space. It's become de jure to talk about these issues in a very substantial way at WHO.
The last thing I want to ask you is, how can people subscribe to your publication?
Thanks, Jamie. You can check us out on GenevaHealthFiles.com to know more about our work. And if you want to subscribe to our newsletter, that's GenevaHealthFiles.substack.com, GenevaHealthFiles.substack.com. Thanks so much. This is a reader-funded initiative, so you're most welcome to read us and subscribe.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.